So how do you learn with this? How do you learn that now that you have, you know how to define options, can I solve problems by using these options? This is where SMDPQ learning comes in. All of you remember SMDPQ learning, right? So I am going to update, I mean the normal, if I take an action, that part is clear, I mean that is a normal Q learning, right? In a particular state, suppose I take a option instead. So what do? I treat this as a durative action, right? In the SMDPQ learning, what happened? We assume that actions have duration, right? So here in hierarchical RL, I start off with an MDP, right? I have defined a set of options on top of that MDP, right? So when I use these options on that MDP, I am going to treat these as durative actions. So the MDP plus options gives me a SMDP.
Yeah.
Good question. You could, right, I will come to that in a minute, right? But the simplest version is you just do, so you take option O in state S, then you update the value of that option in the state S.
So in that case, like is that, won't that be trying to learn the internal policy pi 0?
No. That's why I said I will come to that, hold on. Right. Do we need to write down the SMDPQ learning update again? You guys all know it from last class, right? Great. So the only tricky thing here is the reward, and the reward for the action is going to be the sum of the return that you get from when the option started till when the option ended. Correct? Right. So that's basically it. So last time we had it started from RT and ended at RT plus tau, and then we gave appropriate discounts and everything. So all of that will come into play here, because the option is the durative action, right? So that's essentially why we introduced the SMDP framework in the first place, so that we could handle all of these things. Great. So SMDPQ learning is fine, right? But then we want to do something better, right? So we want to do. Called intra option Q learning, right? So we actually want to take advantage of the fact that the option consists of primitive actions, right, and we want to go and use that as well, right. So what would we do in that case is, I will update Qs comma O in the normal way. Right. Let us assume that when I start pi O, right, so I do actions, these are the actions I see, okay. I mean this is because of the definition of pi O and the sequence of states S1, S2, S3 that I am seeing, right. So I see, let us say that I see S1, S2, Sn, and after I do An in Sn, I terminate, okay. Let us assume that this is the sequence of things I have seen. Okay. So what I can do is I can actually update Qs comma A1, right. So how will I update Qs comma A1? Yes. 1. What goes in here? Max. Okay, max over A, Q, S2, comma A. I cannot use A2 in that expression because why? Because it's Q learning, but why wouldn't I want to use A2 in that expression? Because this is where we come to your point. I am following policy pi naught here, right? So this is not necessarily reflective of the value of taking A1 in state S1. Right, if I had used A2 here, it is the value of taking A1 in S1, assuming I am going to follow pi naught thereafter, and then I will, after pi naught terminates, I will do whatever I want. Right, so if I had used A2 there, that is what I will be learning. Does it make sense? See, normally what you expect in Q learning or SARSA is that this expression is the reward you get for following policy pi thereafter, right, or following optimal policy thereafter, whatever, following policy pi thereafter is what you expect in SARSA. So, if I had used A2 here, I am not following policy pi thereafter, I am actually following pi naught, right. Could very well be that pi naught is the policy that I would have picked there in A2 also, in S2 also, but I do not know that for sure because I never had a choice of picking an action in S2. I picked an action in S1, I was constrained to follow that action in S2 also. Since I did not have the choice of picking the action in S2, I really should not use A2 there and claim that it is SARSA. Okay. So that is why in all this kind of intra option kind of learning mechanisms, you have to use Q learning, you have to be off policy. Okay. So is there anything else I can do other than update? So likewise I can do it for A2 and so on, right? I can update Q. Is there anything else I can do? Can I update any other value function?
Sir, are we maintaining two kinds of actions?
Are we maintaining?
There are primitive actions for every state and there are options also for every state.
Well, it is like an MDP that has like 10 different actions that you can take, right? So, I mean 4 were primitive actions, 6 were options. So, I am maintaining a Q function for 4 primitive actions and the 6 actions, the 6 options also. It is just a single Q function. And it is for solving the original MDP problem. Essentially, I am optimizing the reward function given in that MDP, right?
We are solving both the big problem and the sub problem.
No, I am not solving. Sub problems have been solved, have been encapsulated and given to me as an option policy. I am not changing pi naught anywhere. Yeah.
Then why are we storing all this primitive actions Q values?
Because I am allowed to take the primitive actions also, right? When I come to the state S1 next time, I can either choose to take O or I can choose to take A1. Or A2 or A3 or whatever, right? I'm allowed to take primitive actions.
So, do we use these action values to update option values? As in to change the options or something?
Change pi naught. So, I'll talk about that when I come to max Q. In the options framework itself, as it was originally proposed, they never had a option of changing the option policy, right? So they just let you, they just assumed that the option policy was frozen, and then they said, okay, here go learn, right? They never did this multi-level learning. It's possible to think of mechanisms for doing that as well, right? Then the MaxQ framework made it explicit, right? So there are ways of learning the policy in the options framework also. I mean it is nothing very deep or anything, you just have to be very careful about how you do the bookkeeping. So, you have to make sure that the appropriate reward function is fed into the appropriate value function. So, I will explain that more when we talk about MaxQ, which is one of the other architectures that we have. So, anything else that we can update? How about that? Option gets?
The option.
Option is ended. Can I update this and the option is ended? This is Q S 2 comma O. Can I write an expression like this for Q S 2 comma O is my question.
Do you have an option of taking O in S 2?
When would you have an option of taking O in S 2?
So is S 2 part of the I 0?
Great. Anything else?
Markov.
Option has to be Markov. Right? So, what Q S 2 comma O would be if O starts from S 2 and runs, what will be the value? But O has started in S 1, right? If it is not, if it is semi Markov option, then the policy would be different because I started in S 1 when I call O here, right? So, I should not be using this trajectory for updating the value of S 2 comma O, right? But if S, if O happens to be a Markov option, it does not matter whether I start in S 1, whether I start in S 2 or I start in S 3. I can start in S2 and I can update the value of QS2 comma O, right? It, because it is likely to give me the same sequence of actions. I mean, it is a valid sequence of actions, right? But the only thing is the SMDP reward that I am using should start summing from R2 and not R1. So, I should leave out R1, I should start summing from R2, okay? Great. So, assume I am with Markov options, is there something more that I can do? Assuming I am doing Markov options, is there a more efficient way of updating the value of Q? S comma O.
We just use the next state that it goes to directly.
Mm-hmm.
Use the you can consider it as like truncating over there and then take that value function.
Very good point. So and
gamma Q
gamma
S2 comma S2 comma 8 2 comma 8 2 comma.
You can have an max over max over options that you can take from that state. Max over options. Not what you're doing. Here you can even max over options. Is this fine? Does that sound right? Why did we?
They take the max over all options at S2.
Tell me why.
Tell you because
I'm asking you people, is it right?
Following the policy.
It's off policy. Isn't the max it's not off policy.
What's that?
Isn't that max and that same option? Because the policy itself is a max of all the.
We don't know if pi 0 is the max.
We don't know if pi 0 is the max, right? So we don't know. Pi 0 has just been defined. It's a policy that has been created for me, right? I don't know if I do max whether I get pi 0 or not. On the other hand, I am constrained to take actions according to pi 0. Right?
Then the max frozen.
No, I have chosen O in S1, right? So in S2, I have to take actions according to pi O, not pi 0, pi O, right? So, I have to take actions according to pi O. I am constrained that way, except when I can end at S2. If I end at S2, then I have to do a max. Right? right? So now I don't have to keep a running sum of all the returns, right? I can get by doing this kind of a bootstrapping. So I am writing it separately so that it is clear, but you can actually do this combination of this 2 into single update by using your beta, right. So with probability 1 minus beta, this is what you will do, and with probability beta, this is what you will do. So if you are terminating beta of S2, so if you are terminating in S2, right, so then beta S2 will be 1, right. So this will not happen, so you will multiply this by 1 minus beta here. So if you are terminating in S2, then this will not happen. If you are not terminating in S2, then this will happen. Basically the beta will be 0 and this will happen, right. So essentially I can multiply this by and multiply this by and then I can write everything combined into a single function. Okay, make sense? Everyone, so we have done all kinds of complex things. So the easiest thing, of course, makes your life a lot easier to implement is SMDP Q learning. But then you can do interoption Q learning, can do a whole bunch of things, right? In fact, you can do even something better. What else can you do? What else you think you can do? Now that you know how to do this. Suppose, right? So my pi O of S1 is A1 and my pi O prime of S1 is also A1. Some, these are A1, not the first action, but the first index action, not the first action according to time, but the first action according to some index, right. Essentially what I am saying is both of them give me the same action for S1, right. If I am in state S1, both pi O and pi O prime give me the same action. Now can I think of how I can update given that I have taken action O, option O. I am executing option O. Can I update QS O prime?
What is that? We are doing generalization. If we take O, then we can update O.
No functional approximation here. I can do the same thing. Exactly. So I can do the same thing. Right, so I am just assuming that you can multiply those things, right. I will just write the first expression around. Right, this is an amazing thing, right. So as far as the update equations are concerned, I am only looking at S1, R1, right. I do not care whether that S1, A1, R1, basically that is the combination I am looking at. I do not care whether the A1 came from executing pi O or pi O dash. So I can still do this updation. So if I do a single option execution, I can actually update the value function for all the options which are consistent with that option that I am executing, right. Now let us ask another question.
If it is Markov, can we even do Q of, if it is Markov and if S2 belongs to I, if IO, can we even do Q of S2 comma O for the bootstrapping?
Oh, Q of S2 comma O, I already said, right? Okay, you can do that here. This
is the bootstrapping also.
Yeah, yeah, same kind of bootstrapping. This is exactly where the whole off-policy ratio updation thing got introduced into the RL literature. Not in chapter 5, right? So when so Doina Prickup and Rich Sutton were working on this inter-option queue learning, then they came up with this insight that, hey, even if the options, I mean, they first said that if the options are consistent, if they agree with each other, then I can use the same experience and update the values of different options. And then they came up with this insight, hey, even if they do not agree exactly with each other, as long as they are consistent in the important sampling sense, right, I can use the important sampling ratio and update the values, right. So that is the insight that they came up, and then they went back and said, hey, why did I have to be in the option space, right, I just need two different policies, the behavior policy and the estimation policy, right, this is what happens, right. So your behavior policy is pi o, your estimation policy is pi o naught. pi o prime is your estimation policy, your behavior policy is pi o. Then they said, oh, okay, this is a great thing, which we can do more generalization, we can learn, so we can actually maintain this huge library of options, right, that differ from one another with in some small respects, but I can learn about all of those options while I am executing only one option. So that is the insight that led to this whole off policy setup that we looked at in the Monte Carlo chapter. Right, and then they went back and then they started talking about off policy learning, and in fact this is where the on policy, off policy, the dichotomy that we talk about actually came into the literature from this interoption queue learning ideas. Okay, and then we went and backfitted everything, we started calling queue learning as off policy, SARSA as on policy and all of those, but that started only in the late 90s. So, cool. So any questions on this? So if we can implement very efficient option learning algorithms, right? What is it? You have to come up with options first. That's a great question. Yeah, so we have to come up with the options first. Still a very active open area of research. So I don't know, if time permits, maybe next class or something, or maybe in the class after the exam, I'll talk about attempts people have made for option discovery and so on and so forth, right. Not too many out there, but there are some interesting attempts that have been done, right. So we will talk about that in the, maybe in the last class. Right now I want to move on, talk about the other hierarchical frameworks. So far so good, right. So options are good, yeah. And I should say that because of the simplicity of the entire option framework, right, options are the most popularly used hierarchical RL thing. So that is why I spent so much time, I went so slowly on this. One thing which you should point out, there are a few things which are a little dissatisfying, right. So for example, the policy pi naught, right, it is not entirely clear where pi naught is defined, you know. So if you think about it, we have the initiation set, these are states where a policy can start, right. But once it starts here, can the policy go everywhere? Not really, right, it depends on the termination set. If the dynamics of the problem is such that the termination set cuts you off from the initiation set, right, so those states you can't actually reach, right. So there is no clear specification of you know, admissible states for the option. These are the states that this option will visit and things like this. These are all left to be inferred from other things that have been defined, right. So what else is missing is things like whatever I was talking to you about here, right. So when I am actually executing option O, when I come to a state, I will behave differently, even if it is a Markov option, right. I will behave differently if as opposed to when I am executing option O dash, right. But for an outside observer, it will look like, either it will look like I am behaving in a non-Markov fashion or I am behaving in a stochastic fashion. Right, I come there, I do action A1 sometimes, I do action A2 sometimes. It's the same state, yes. I do action A1 sometimes, I'm doing action A2 sometimes. But I might be executing a deterministic policy. It depends on what option I am executing when I come to A1, right. The fact that the option is really part of the option you are executing is really part of the internal state is never made explicit in the options framework, right. There is no notion of internal state or anything. They are all left to, you know, kind of the implementer's interpretation of options, okay. So, there are a lot of things which the options framework really does not specify, okay. In some sense, that is the power of the options framework. You can go fill in whatever details you want for it. But it is also in some sense, you know, dissatisfying about the framework in that it lets you do a lot of this work yourself.